Hello and welcome. My guest today is the president of the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry and also the country head of HSBC in India. The question that many people are asking is, where is the Indian growth story headed? Let's put it to Naina Lal Kidwai. Welcome, Naina Lal Kidwai. Last year, you said the mood in India is not very optimistic when it comes to business and the economy. How do you see it a year down the line? Do you think things have improved in India? Has the mood become more optimistic?
I have actually captured the mood right now in a phrase of cautious optimism. What we would love is for a return to the euphoria of 2 to 3 years ago. And I think we have to work to push the economy, to push sentiment in that direction in order to get us back to the 8% plus growth, which is what our five-year plan envisages in terms of one of the scenarios, and I would say in terms of the ideal scenario. I have no doubt that we can get it back up to an 8% growth rate in the next 2 to 3 years if we can line up our strategies in that direction.
So what's holding it back? What needs to be lined up?
Well, I think there is low-hanging fruit, and the easiest one, to my mind, to resolve is if the nation can align behind GST, the goods and service tax, which we believe can add 2% straight to the GDP of the country. That one step, it aids in terms of the whole process of revenue collection. It makes it neater in terms of the investment environment. It's good for industry. It's good for the fiscal deficit and therefore for the country. And essentially, it's good also for the consumer because there's transparency in the way taxes get charged and duplicity of taxes get resolved and looked at in a clear way. So given that it's a win-win, it's unfortunate that we haven't actually got the GST regime in place. I have no doubt that the government is working to get this on track. We are going to need an alignment across all parties, centre and state, in order to ensure that this gets done. Industry has certainly supported this and will continue to push for this particular reform in the immediate future.
But that's not the only reform or only change that you're looking for. As an industrial body, you're looking at many things across the board. How about interest rates or, let's say, change in policy with regard to functioning of industry? You've been pushing for those. So is the mood really optimistic now? Do you see things happen or is it still at the talking stage?
So the sentiment in India right now for investment just isn't there. There are companies that have a lot of cash on their balance sheet. That money is not being invested. The fact is that the entire investment climate needs a serious push. This can happen.
But why aren't they investing that cash?
Well, I think one part of it is regulatory issues. There's a concern that there's a lot of backtracking happening on regulation. And it isn't just tax. It is regulatory frameworks in different parts of the system. It could be on gas pricing on the one side. It could be on coal on the other. But because of the... And telecoms, we know, has been on the boil. So particularly where there are large investments, and that is typically in infrastructure sectors, which is where government and regulation become critical, there is a perception right now that there isn't enough consistency in the way the regulations are cast or indeed executed going forward. And that causes a lot of concern and certainly does not help in terms of investment climate. So that becomes one key area that needs addressing.
But have you seen any change take place on that area in recent times?
Most certainly. I think there have been announcements on the tax front, which had caused concerns in terms of retrospectivity. In order to sort through that, we've seen a deferment of what were really more problems for the foreign institutional community around GAR or tax avoidance therein, which have also got deferred, and very good committee reports from people like the Shom Committee, which suggests that some of the suggestions in there are indeed being evaluated and taken on board. So there is movement, which is positive. There's no doubt on that. Some of the regulatory stuff, some is in the courts, others is still up for negotiation and discussion, the sooner we can resolve those, the better, because it will enable the investment climate to go forward. My big concern there is continues to be in the power sector. On the one hand, it suffered because of the whole sort of coal supply chain and renegotiation of contracts therein, and the whole way in which coal contracts were given out is now being considered in some detail. Now, the good news is the Cabinet Committee for Investments has in fact been meeting on exactly this, and I have no doubt that they will resolve at least some of those projects, allow those projects to move ahead. Because as long as we have brownfields, projects which have started, not yet completed, not yet closed, that remain in this area of limbo, it would suggest that not only those projects suffer, but sentiment in terms of new investment in those projects also suffers, on the one hand. On the other side, the issue that we have is the fact that, therefore, new investment doesn't come in. And banks are reluctant to fund the new projects because money is stuck in the old projects. So it's almost more important to get the old projects sorted out so that new investments can happen rather than just look for new investments. And I think that is the focus of the CCI, the Cabinet Committee of Investments, to look at some of these large projects. And I would certainly hope that on the power front, we would see the cleaning up and execution of these projects going forward. If India can execute on all the power projects we had started on, I understand that we could, in fact, be power neutral by 2015.
Let me put this to you in another way. If you were the finance minister of India, under the current situation...
I'm glad I'm not the finance minister of India.
Is it that bad?
Such a difficult job. Yes.
But is the situation that bad?
It's a very tough job. I mean, what we have is very little room to basically wriggle one way or other.
And you're talking of this economically or politically?
Economically, because if just looking at numbers, we have a FISC which is out of control, and the finance minister has done well to suggest that it needs to actually be brought down. He's done it before, and I'm sure he will be able to do it again. But the fact is that at its current levels, it is a huge risk
and
to the country.
And on the other hand, you have inflation that is threatening to go up again.
Yeah.
It's not really under control as yet.
Correct. So we're a high inflation country.
Yeah.
And inflation at these rates does not encourage the Reserve Bank of India to bring interest rates down.
Which is in
Whereas
fact needed.
Investment wants and is crying out for cheaper money in order to be able to invest. Exporters are crying out for lower interest rates so they can compete with global regimes where, in fact, interest rates are much, much lower. So we are not in a comfortable situation when it comes to the FIS. We are not in a comfortable situation when it comes to overall GDP growth levels sub 6%, which the finance minister himself has said it looks like 5.6 and 5.8 if we're lucky. These aren't great numbers.
So I come back to the question. If you were the finance minister, what would you do with these constraints, and how would you pull the economy out of this sort of the doldrums, if one may say, yeah, where it's rolling right
we
now?
We need a pro-growth, pro-investment structure. Right now, the private sector is crying out for support. And let us face it, the engines of growth in this country are driven by the private sector. We cannot ignore the services sector, which has been an engine of growth, or indeed industry and manufacturing, which has fallen way behind. And for all of this, we need strategies, plans, incentives that will enable investment, which will enable growth. With this growth comes employment, which is critical for the country. Without employment, we would have civil strife. So it's going to be critical to bring the investment climate in the country back up to where it's been in the last couple of years. And for that, it's much more than just sentiment. We need the sentiment to change, and I think the sentiment has changed. We have, fortunately, in the last 2 months, at least seen that the government is serious about getting some of the important bills through. There is a reform agenda. The stock markets have reflected the mood. And typically, the wealth effect created from good equity markets and good real estate prices is usually that consumers, customers begin to drive growth because of demand at the retail level, and that is good for industry. Industry also, as it looks at some of the regulatory cleaning up and clarity will, I'm sure, take its cue. So one aspect would be the demand itself would drive investment, and the other that there's more comfort with the regulatory regime and policy and consistency, which will encourage investment to return. So I think getting investment back is very important. On the revenue side, revenues go up if there's growth. So if we have a robust, strong, growing industry and service sector, revenues go up. We clearly have to do a lot more in terms of widening the tax net. In a country of our size, as you know, the number of taxpayers is dismal. It's really small. What we need is a much wider base for collection, and that needs to clearly be addressed and continue to be addressed. So on the other side, expenditure, the worry that many of us have is that as we go forward into an election in 2014, that there's a danger that the budget becomes populist. I don't think we have any room for new programs or plans. We need to be able to implement on old plans much better. Let's make sure that that money is set aside, and there's a lot of money in different plans, particularly for the bottom of the pyramid, get implemented well. And the experiments that are going on through cash transfers and with the help of the Aadhaar scheme are invaluable for the country.
You've achieved a lot in life. You've been with a number of organizations. You're currently heading HSBC in India. You're also heading FICCI. What is on your agenda beyond this? What is it that you really want to achieve into the future?
If I can answer that as President FICCI, which is this year, which is a very important year for India, it's a very important year for us to establish that we are part of the global program, that we are the economy that everyone expects us to be, which is a high growth, important, maybe second only to China in terms of the way the world engages with us. We've got to do a fair bit this year to make sure we don't lose the plot. So the role that FICCI will play and is playing this year is to ensure that this isn't about hype and talking about India, about the things that and the potential that we have, but now about demonstrating that that potential is a reality and that we can and are, in fact, an investment destination. We have to recognize that we are not an easy place for people to do business. That reputation is known far and wide, so we're not going to be able to duck that. But can we demonstrate that despite that, India cannot be ignored, that any player, global player, needs to be in India?
Well, we wish you luck and thank you for sharing your views with us.
Right, thank you.